Hello and welcome to this Biology 6 lecture on osmosis, diffusion, and transport across membranes. Now, the two major topics of this lecture, osmosis and diffusion, we've actually already covered in the water lecture. So some of the topics that you'll be hearing about in this lecture should be familiar to you from that water lecture, but we're going to go into more details about them in today's lecture. And I will review osmosis and diffusion as we go through them, but still at the same time, it might be a good idea for you to rewatch the water lecture just if you're a little shaky on the basic concepts of osmosis and diffusion. Okay, so we will start off with diffusion. So a good way to picture diffusion is this. Imagine that you had a dropper that had some green ink in it, and you had a beaker of pure water, and then imagine you put one drop of that green ink into the water like you see here. Now, when that the solutes that we're going to be talking about when we describe diffusion are the green ink molecules. Okay, now if you actually did this experiment, at first you would see the green ink molecules, the solute molecules, all concentrated right here. You know, they're at a high concentration there. But in the rest of the beaker, they are at a very low concentration. You know, it's essentially pure water. There are no green solutes there. But if you did this experiment and you just watched the high concentration zone of the green solute molecules, you would see them spreading out, right? After a few minutes, it would look like this. Well, what you're seeing there is called diffusion. And in the lecture handout, it defines diffusion as the movement of solute molecules from their area of high concentration to their areas of low concentration. You know, that's what's happening, right? They are moving from the high concentration areas to the surrounding low concentration areas. That's why it goes from looking like that to looking like that. Another way of saying the same thing, another way of saying diffusion, is that solutes spread out, right? Because that's what they're doing as they move from the high concentration area to the low concentration area. They're spreading out. And there's yet, in fact, another way of phrasing diffusion. You could say it's solutes moving down their concentration gradient. And when we say a concentration gradient, we mean an area where there's a high concentration of the solute right next to where there's an area of the low where there's a low concentration of that solute. So that's a concentration gradient where there's a high concentration right next to a low concentration of the solute. And when we say solutes are moving down their concentration gradient, we mean that they are moving from their high concentration area to their low concentration area. Okay, so yeah, we define diffusion as the movement of solute from an area of high concentration to its area of low concentration, or we can say that solutes move down their concentration gradient. And when I click the button, we'll see essentially a close-up of these green solute molecules all concentrated here, and then we'll see them diffuse, we'll see them spread out. I was just showing here that solutes keep diffusing until they are evenly spread out, until there is no more concentration gradient. But what I was about to say, here it is. Here's a close-up of those green solutes at the beginning of the experiment when they're all concentrated together. When we say solutes are diffusing, they are moving from their area of high concentration to the areas of their low concentration, which just means they're spreading out, or you can say they are moving down their concentration gradient. Okay, now incidentally, it's not just green ink solute molecules that diffuse. All solutes have this natural tendency to diffuse, to spread out. It's just the natural direction that solutes go from their high concentration area to their low concentration area. So what I want you to do is to train your mind so that whenever you see a concentration gradient, you know, high concentration area right next to low concentration area, you just automatically know, like, okay, those solutes want to move from that high concentration area to that low concentration area. That's the natural direction that solutes move. And to make an analogy of that, imagine there are some boulders up here at a high elevation on this hillside. Their natural direction is to move down, right? And so, you know, you wouldn't be surprising if you saw one roll down the hill, because that's the direction that it naturally wants to go. You'd be very surprised if you saw one move in the other direction, like a boulder rolling up a hill, right? Anyway, so just like you just naturally know objects like boulders move from their high elevation to their low elevation. That's their natural direction. Just wrap your mind around that all solutes want to move from their high concentration area to their low concentration area. Okay, well, there's something interesting about cells and diffusion. If we repeat this experiment with the green solute molecules here, but we put a cell inside the beaker of the water, what we would find is that the cell membrane is a barrier that blocks those solutes from diffusing into the cell. Now notice the solutes still diffuse, the solutes still spread out, but the solutes were not able to diffuse through the cell membrane. And so that's what I say is the interesting result. Cell membranes are barriers that block most solutes from diffusing through the membrane. And we might ask, well, does that work? Why is it, how can the cell membrane be a barrier that stops the solutes from diffusing? Well, let's imagine zooming in on the cell membrane right there. Here it is. And, oh yeah, so here's a little animation. We see those solutes diffusing, but as you can see, the membrane's acting as a barrier that's blocking them from diffusing into the cell. So sure, the solutes still diffuse, they still spread out, but they're not able to diffuse into the cell because the membrane blocks them. Okay, so what I was saying was, well, how exactly does the membrane block the solutes from diffusing? And to answer that question, let's imagine zooming in on the cell membrane a little bit more. Here's the cell membrane right there. Now, if I were to ask you, as a review question, what is the major molecule that cell membranes are made out of? I got ahead of myself here. There it is. What's the major molecule that cell membranes are made out of? And the answer is phospholipids. Each little circle with the two tails hanging down is a phospholipid molecule. Okay, yeah, so the cell membrane's a phospholipid bilayer, and it acts as a barrier that blocks most solutes from diffusing through the membrane. Okay, but the question I was posing is, well, how is it that the membrane, the phospholipid bilayer, can block the solutes? And the answer relates to the like mixes with like principle. The like mixes with like principle tells us that hydrophilic things want to mix with other hydrophilic things, not with hydrophobic things. And as it turns out, most solutes are hydrophilic, but the membrane is hydrophobic. And so that's why the membrane is able to block the solutes, because, you know, for those hydrophilic solutes to pass through the membrane, they would have to mix with the membrane as they were passing through. And the like mixes with like principle tells us hydrophilic things don't want to mix with hydrophobic things. Here's a little bit more detailed answer. So yeah, remember the major building block molecules of the cell membrane are called phospholipids, and phospholipids are hydrophobic, especially the two tails. Those are called the hydrophobic tails, or sometimes the fatty acid tails of the phospholipid, and those are very hydrophobic. Whereas, yeah, most solute molecules are very hydrophilic. And so as I was saying, for those molecules to pass through the membrane, those molecules would have to temporarily mix with the hydrophobic phospholipids, and the like mixes with like principle tells us hydrophilic things don't want to mix with hydrophobic things. Okay, so the membrane is a barrier to most solutes. There are, however, two exceptions to this rule of the membrane being a barrier to molecules. The first exception is this: water molecules can pass very easily through cell membranes. And that's a little unexpected, or at least it was unexpected to me when I first learned it, because water molecules are hydrophilic. You know, water molecules mix with water, and that's our definition of hydrophilic. So water molecules, despite the fact that they are hydrophilic, can pass right through the hydrophobic cell membrane, and I never really figured out a good explanation as to why that happens, but it's true. So water molecules go right through cell membranes. And the other way that the membrane is not a barrier is this: for hydrophobic solutes, you know, most solutes are hydrophilic, like the little green ones here represent hydrophilic solutes, but there are some hydrophobic solutes, and hydrophobic solutes can pass right through cell membranes because the cell membrane is hydrophobic and the solute is hydrophobic, and so the solute is not afraid to mix with the cell membrane, which means it can pass right through. So there you have it. The cell membrane is a barrier to most solutes, because most solutes are hydrophilic, but water molecules and hydrophobic solutes can go right through cell membranes. Okay, so we're going to now talk about three ways that solute molecules can pass through cell membranes. Even though the cell membranes are a barrier to most solutes, sometimes the cell does need to bring things through the cell membrane. For instance, sometimes the cell, for example, might need to get some nutrients from the outside and bring them into the cell. So yeah, there are three major ways that solutes can pass through a cell membrane, and in the lecture handout I spell them out. They are called solutes can pass through the cell membrane by a process called simple diffusion. Solutes can pass through the cell membrane through channel proteins in the membrane, and solutes can pass through the cell membrane by some processes called endocytosis and exocytosis. So what we're going to do now in this part of the lecture is go through those three ways that solutes can pass through the cell membrane one at a time and explain what they are. Okay, so our oh yeah, so let's zoom out again on the cell here for a second. Go on, cell, zoom out. There we go. Okay, so the first way that solutes can go through the cell membrane is a process called simple diffusion. It's defined in your lecture handout as the diffusion of a molecule directly through the membrane phospholipids. And we just sort of talked about, what sort of solute molecule can do that, and the answer was hydrophobic solute molecules. So imagine those are some hydrophobic solute molecules, because the cell membrane itself is hydrophobic. It's not a barrier to those hydrophobic solutes. So hydrophobic solute molecules, when they diffuse, can pass right through cell membranes. And so, yeah, we call that anytime a solute can go right through the phospholipid bilayer, we call that diffusion process simple diffusion. And only hydrophobic molecules can do simple diffusion through cell membranes. Now, what sort of hydrophobic molecules typically pass through a cell membrane? Well, one of the more typical types of hydrophobic solutes that are found inside the body are what are called steroid lipids. So in our lecture on the biological macromolecules, we learned that one type of macromolecule in the body are called lipids, and all lipid molecules are hydrophobic. And there were three subcategories of lipid molecules. There were triglycerides, phospholipids, and steroid lipids. And so what I'm saying is the steroid, well, what you see here are three examples of steroid lipids. All steroid lipids have this backbone of four fused rings of carbon that you see here in kind of the orangey color. And many hormones are steroid lipids. Not all hormones, but many hormones are. And you see some examples here. Testosterone, the male hormone, estrogen and progesterone, the female hormone, a couple of other hormones. Anyway, so you see that many hormones are steroid hormones. Anyway, steroids are a type of lipid. Lipids are hydrophobic, so steroid hormones can pass right through cell membranes. And unfortunately, I don't have a picture of it here, but there are two very important gases that are also hydrophobic, and so therefore, these gases can also pass through cell membranes by simple diffusion. And if you look in your lecture handout, it names them oxygen gas and carbon dioxide gas, which are written as O2 and CO2, respectively. Yeah, so oxygen and carbon dioxide are hydrophobic, and so they can go right through cell membranes by simple diffusion. Okay, so just to review, hydrophobic solutes can diffuse right through the cell membrane phospholipid bilayer. And when the hydrophobic solutes do that, we say that the process is called simple diffusion. Okay, now let's say that for some reason the cell needs to bring inside of it some of these hydrophilic solutes. The little green dots are the hydrophilic solutes. Well, we know that because they're hydrophilic, they can't go right through the phospholipid bilayer, right? Well, the cell has a way of bringing hydrophilic solutes through the membrane if the cell needs those solutes. And the cell can do that with the aid of what's called a channel protein. So let's re-zoom in on the cell membrane and we'll see one of these channel proteins. So there's the phospholipid bilayer. A channel protein looks like this. And we talked about channel proteins in an earlier lecture, the lecture on biological macromolecules. So channel proteins are sometimes called carrier proteins, and sometimes they're also called pores. So those are, they are proteins in the cell membrane, so they are a type of membrane protein that form a tunnel to allow solutes to pass from one side of the membrane to the other side of the membrane. Now, these channel proteins are not just a wide open tunnel that any solute can move through. Each channel protein is highly specific to transport just the solute molecules that it's supposed to be transporting. And what makes each channel protein specific is the channel protein has a binding site for just the solute molecules that it's supposed to be transporting. Oh yes, there's a channel protein, and let's see one of these hydrophilic solutes like that. Yeah, so each channel protein has a binding site for the solute molecules it's supposed to be transporting. And so, you know, it only binds to and only transports the molecule it's supposed to be transporting. And we've talked about this sort of thing before with proteins. We say that the protein's binding site has lock and key specificity for just the molecule it's supposed to be binding to. Okay, anyway, so once the channel protein has bound the molecule it's supposed to transport, it then opens up a little bit and lets the solute molecule pass through. Now, what if some different solute molecule comes along, like this one here? This channel protein would not transport it just because it doesn't fit into the channel protein's binding site. You know, the channel protein needs that lock and key specificity to transport a molecule. And here's another one. Here's another solute molecule. It doesn't fit in the binding site, and so this channel protein is just not going to transport it. Okay, now, so what if the cell wanted to also transport in, let's say, this solute molecule? Well, the cell would need a different channel protein, since each channel protein is just specific for the solute molecule types it's supposed to be transporting. Cells can have several different channel proteins in their membrane. You know, the cell needs one channel protein type for each of the different solute molecules that the cell needs to pass through the cell membrane. Okay, so anyway, just to review, these channel proteins, sometimes called carrier proteins, proteins in the cell membrane that basically form a tunnel, but, you know, not a wide open tunnel, a tunnel with a specific binding site for just the solute molecules it's supposed to be transporting. Okay, here's another channel protein. Some channel proteins actually have two different binding sites, and that allows the channel protein to simultaneously transport two different solute molecules. And let me show you that. Let's say this channel protein is that type, so it has a binding site for this purple molecule, and the channel protein also has a binding site for this green molecule here. So these are the solute molecules that this transport, this channel protein is supposed to be transporting. And so, yeah, it needs a binding site for each molecule type that it's supposed to be transporting. But here, when I click the button, you'll see that it transports both molecules simultaneously. Here it goes. That one goes in and that one goes out. Well, what you just saw here is called co-transport. Co-transport is defined as when the channel protein transports two different solute molecules simultaneously. And, you know, like I was saying, the all channel proteins are very specific for just the solutes they're supposed to be transporting because they have binding sites. And so this is not an exception to this rule. Channel protein here has binding sites for the two molecules it's supposed to be transporting. Matter of fact, I think it goes into a loop here. Here you see this channel protein doing co-transport. Now, not all channel proteins can do co-transport. Most channel proteins only have a binding site for one type of solute molecule, and so most channel proteins only allow one solute molecule type to pass through the cell membrane, but other channel proteins have two binding sites for two different types of solute molecules, and those types of channel proteins can do co-transport. Oh, one last thing about co-transport. So in this example that I'm showing you of co-transport, notice one solute molecule is exiting the cell and one solute molecule is entering the cell. That's not always the case with co-transport. In some types of co-transport, both molecules are moving into the cell through the channel protein. And in other types of co-transport, both molecules are exiting the cell So co-transport just means the channel protein binds to and transports two different solute molecule types. Co-transport doesn't necessarily mean that one solute goes in and the other goes out, or they both go in and they both go out. All those are different possibilities for co-transport. Okay, well, let me take away that channel protein that goes co that does co-transport and go back to this view of the cell membrane. Okay, so we know we've been discussing how solute molecules can cross the cell membrane, and just to review, one way that solute molecules can get through is called simple diffusion, where the solute molecules pass right through the phospholipid bilayer. But remember, only hydrophobic solute molecules can do simple diffusion through a cell membrane. If we want to talk about hydrophilic solute molecules, they can't diffuse through the hydrophobic cell membrane, and so for hydrophilic molecules, the major way that they can get through the cell is with the help of a channel protein. Okay, so let's imagine that the cell needs some of these solute molecules inside. Maybe these are some sort of nutrient molecule for the cell. Okay, so first of all, notice that there's a high concentration of the solute molecule outside the cell here, and as you can see, there's a low concentration of the solute molecule inside the cell. In other words, there's a concentration gradient here from high concentration to low concentration. So we know from the principle of diffusion that these solute molecules want to move down here into the cell. That's their natural direction because that's down their concentration gradient. But of course, they can't do it because they're hydrophilic and the membrane is hydrophobic. So if the cell wants to bring those molecules inside, all the cell has to do is have a channel protein for those molecules. And then the solute molecules will be able to bind to the channel protein, and the solute molecules will just therefore automatically move down their concentration gradient into the cell with the help of that channel protein. And so what we see here, the process you see here, is called facilitated diffusion. So let's analyze the name. The diffusion part of the name makes sense because it is diffusion. The solutes are moving down their concentration gradient. The solutes are moving from high concentration side to low concentration side. That's diffusion. But they say it's facilitated diffusion. To facilitate means to allow something to happen, to make it easier to happen, right? And so what they're saying is these hydrophilic solutes couldn't pass through the membrane on their own. They can't diffuse right through the membrane on their own. They need the help of a channel protein to facilitate their diffusion. That's why it's called facilitated diffusion. Now, notice that the channel protein does not need to get any energy to let these solutes pass through, because the solutes just have the natural direction of wanting to move down their concentration gradient. And so that's one characteristic of facilitated diffusion. The channel protein, the cell does not have to expend any energy to move solutes through their through the cell membrane, through the channel protein, if it's diffusion. And so facilitated diffusion is sometimes called passive transport. Passive means no energy. And so it's transport of the solute molecule without the cell having to expend any energy. All right, well, so to recap this, facilitated diffusion is where solutes move across the cell membrane down their concentration gradient, from high concentration side to low concentration side, through a channel protein. Okay, now we're going to imagine a different scenario. So here we see the cell again, and there's a channel protein. And notice that there's a large concentration of these solute molecules outside the cell, but a much smaller concentration of those solute molecules inside the cell. And so, as you know, the natural direction these solute molecules want to move is into the cell, right? Because that's the direction of diffusion. That's down their concentration gradient. But let's imagine, for whatever reason, the cell wants to move the solutes inside to the outside, right? And it wants to move the solute against its concentration gradient, against the direction of diffusion. Now, why would the cell want to move a solute against the solute's diffusion direction? Well, there are various reasons the cell might want to do that, so let's not worry about that. But let's just take it for granted. The cell wants to move that solute against its concentration gradient. Well, the cell can do that. You know, there's a channel protein that's got a binding site there, and so that solute molecule can load up onto the channel protein. But here's the thing. For the channel protein to move that solute against the solute's concentration gradient, the cell is going, in other words, to move that solute from its low concentration side to the high concentration side, the cell is going to have to expend energy to do that. And that's called active transport, where the cell moves a solute against the solute's concentration gradient, low concentration side to high concentration side, through a channel protein, but the cell always has to expend energy to do it. And this little glowing thing represents the energy that the cell has to give to the channel protein for the channel protein to pump that solute against the solute's natural direction of wanting to move into the cell. Okay, yeah, so that's active transport. It's, in fact, active transport is sometimes called pumping of solutes. Now, why does the cell have to expend energy to do active transport of solutes? Well, it relates to something I talked about earlier. You know, so these solute molecules here, they're at a high concentration here, and they are at a lower concentration inside the cell. So the natural direction these molecules want to move is down their concentration gradient, from high concentration side to low concentration side, just like objects want to move from high elevation to low elevation, right? And so, you know, it doesn't take any energy for an object to move downhill. Objects do that kind of automatically. But if you want to move an object like this rock against the natural direction, you know, if you want to move the rock uphill, that requires energy. So the point I'm making is anytime you move an object against the natural direction it wants to go, you can do it, but you have to expend energy to do it. And so that's why the cell needs to expend energy to pump solutes against their concentration gradient from their low concentration side to the high concentration side. And yeah, we call that process active transport. Movement of a solute molecule from its low concentration side to its high concentration side through a channel protein and active transport. They call it active because it always requires energy. Okay, there are two different sources that energy can come from. For some active transport proteins, the energy comes from ATP molecules. And that shouldn't surprise you too much because we've been talking for quite a while that ATP molecules are the major energy source molecules for the proteins in your cell. Yeah, so here's one of these channel proteins that does active transport of a solute, and it uses ATP as its energy source. So there's the solute molecule loading up in the binding site of the channel protein, and then the channel protein grabs an ATP molecule for energy source, and using the energy of ATP, it can pump the solute. And so yes, when a channel protein uses ATP as its energy source for active transport of a solute, we say that the process primary active transport is going on. Primary active transport means where it's active transport with ATP as the energy source. So here, I'll put it on a loop here. You can see this channel protein does primary active transport to pump its solute molecules against their concentration gradient. There is, however, a second way that channel proteins can do active transport, a second way they can get energy to do active transport. And let me explain what this is. So here's this another channel protein. And again, this channel protein is one that will do active transport. This channel protein is interested in pumping the channel protein is interested in pumping this purple square solute molecule against that purple molecule's concentration gradient. In other words, it wants to pump this one from its low concentration side to its high concentration side, right? That's active transport, moving a solute molecule against its concentration gradient. But this channel protein is not going to use ATP for its energy source. So where is it going to get the energy? Well, notice that there's this other solute molecule, the one that's shown in green here, that is at a high concentration on this side and a low concentration on this side. So that solute molecule just naturally by diffusion wants to move into the cell, right? Well, so some of these channel proteins that do active transport on a solute also have a binding site for a different solute. And when the channel protein lets that solute go down its concentration gradient, when the channel protein allows that green solute to go down its concentration gradient, because that's the natural direction, that green solute molecule is going to come zooming right through the channel protein. And anytime something's moving, that's a form of energy, right? And so what this channel protein is going to do is it's going to use some of the energy of allowing this solute molecule to go down its concentration gradient as an energy source to pump this solute molecule against its concentration gradient. Now, I'll show you here. So the channel protein binds this one, and since when it opens up, this solute molecule is going to go shooting on through down its concentration gradient because that's the direction diffusion wants it to go. But some of the motion energy of that molecule going down its concentration gradient is going to be transferred, is going to be the energy source to pump this solute molecule against its concentration gradient. It's almost as if this one's going to knock into that one and bounce it on out. Here we go. Yeah, and so what that sort of process is called is secondary active transport. So it's still active transport for these purple solute molecules here, the square ones, because it's that molecule was pumped against its concentration gradient. So that makes it active transport. But they use the term secondary active transport if the energy source, you know, is not ATP. The energy source is a different solute molecule going down its concentration gradient through the same channel protein. And we'll see it on loop here. Here's more secondary active transport. And here's more secondary active transport of that purple solute molecule right there. All right. So notice that secondary active transport always involves co-transport. Remember, the term co-transport is where the channel protein simultaneously transports two solute molecules. And so, yes, if the channel protein is doing secondary active transport, just by part of the definition of secondary active transport, it has to be a channel protein that can be doing co-transport because, you know, it involves one solute going down its concentration gradient as the energy source for pumping of the other solute against its concentration gradient. Okay, well, so what I'm going to do now is show you, it's kind of a drill. I'm going to show you different types of solutes crossing the cell membrane. And the drill is, when I show it to you, I'm going to ask you, was that simple diffusion? Was that facilitated diffusion? Was that primary active transport? Was that secondary active transport? Okay, let us see here. Okay, so here's a cell. And these are supposed to be glucose molecules. So notice that the glucose molecules are at a higher concentration outside the cell than inside the cell. And let's say that the cell wants to allow some of those glucose molecules in. And so the cell has a channel protein to allow it to do that. And I guess maybe as a quick review question is, why do you think the cell wants to let in those glucose molecules? And the answer is the cell wants those glucose molecules as a fuel source so that the cell can do cellular aerobic respiration and, you know, get energy for itself. But that was just kind of a random review question. The point I'm making here is the cell is going to allow some of these glucose molecules to go from their high concentration side to their low concentration side inside the cell, and those glucose molecules are going to go through that channel protein. Here we see that. Yum, yum, yum. The cell got a glucose, and here it happens again. Okay, so looking at this here, here's your drill question. Are we looking at simple diffusion, or are we looking at facilitated diffusion? Or are we looking at primary active transport, or are we looking at secondary active transport? And the answer is that we were looking at facilitated diffusion, also called passive transport, because you remember that is when a solute passes through the cell membrane through a channel protein, and the solute is going down its concentration gradient. The solute is diffusing from its high concentration side to its low concentration side. All right, let me give you another drill review question here. So here's a here's the scenario. So for this cell right here, there is a high concentration of calcium ions outside the cell and a low concentration of calcium ions inside the cell. And let's say that the cell wants to move some of these calcium ions from the inside to the outside. In other words, the cell wants to move some of these calcium ions from its low concentration side, from their low concentration side to their high concentration side. And so the cell has a channel protein for doing that. So that channel protein is a binding site for those calcium ions, and then the cell uses an ATP molecule to provide energy for that channel protein to move the solute against its concentration gradient, like you see there and like you see here. Okay, so what is this? Is this simple diffusion? Is it facilitated diffusion? Is it primary active transport, or is it secondary active transport? And the answer to this is primary active transport. Primary active transport we defined, remember, as where the cell uses a channel protein to pump a solute molecule against the solute molecule's concentration gradient from low concentration side to high concentration side, and where the cell uses ATP as the energy source to pump the solute against its concentration gradient. Okay, good. Let's do yet another drill. So here's the cell, and let me paint out the scenario here for this drill question. There's a large concentration of sodium ions outside the cell, and there is a much lower concentration of sodium ions inside the cell. I know I'm not showing any sodium ions inside, but imagine the cell has a few sodium ions inside. But the point is, there's a much larger concentration of sodium ions outside than there is inside. Inside the cell, there is a large concentration of potassium ions. And imagine outside there are a few potassium ions. I'm not showing any potassium ions, but imagine there's a smaller concentration of potassium ions outside. Okay, so now let's say that the cell wants to move sodium ions against their concentration gradient. The cell wants to move sodium ions from the inside of the cell to the outside. You know, that's against the concentration gradient. And similarly, the cell wants to move potassium ions from the outside to the inside, and that's also against the concentration gradient of the potassium ions, right? Because they are low concentration here and outside there. So, yeah, the cell wants to move the sodium ions into the cell against the sodium ions concentration gradient. Sorry, the cell wants to move sodium ions out of the cell against the sodium ions concentration gradient, and the cell wants to move potassium ions into the cell against the potassium ions concentration gradient. And so the cell has a channel protein for doing that. And so let's see, the channel protein binds up some potassium ions on that side and binds up some sodium ions on this side. And then the channel protein uses ATP as its energy source to transport all of those ions against their respective concentration gradients, like you see there. Okay, so what is that? Is that simple diffusion? Is it facilitated diffusion? Is it primary active transport, or is it secondary active transport? Actually, let's watch it a couple times there. Yeah, it's moving the sodium ions from their low concentration side to their high concentration side, and likewise, it's moving the potassium ions from their low concentration side to their high concentration side. And it uses the energy of ATP to do those two. Well, so what is it? The answer is, drum roll please, primary active transport. It's primary active transport. First of all, it's active transport because molecules are mo being moved against their concentration gradients. The sodiums are being moved against their concentration gradient, and the potassium ions are mo being moved against their concentration gradient. So it's definitely active transport. And active transport always requires an energy source, and the molecule that's providing the energy to the transport protein is ATP, and so that fits our definition of primary active transport. It's active transport where ATP is the energy source. Now, at first you may say, wait a minute, isn't this secondary active transport? Because isn't secondary active transport where the channel protein moves solutes in both directions? Well, that's not what secondary active transport. Secondary active transport is where one of the two solutes going through the transport, the channel protein, is going down its concentration gradient. And the solute going down its concentration gradient is the energy source for the solute that's being pumped against its concentration gradient. And notice that's not what's happening here, right? Neither the potassiums nor the sodiums are going down their concentration gradient. The potassiums and the sodiums are both going against their concentration gradient, so it's not secondary active transport. Anytime the energy source for moving a solute against its concentration gradient is ATP, just by definition, that's primary active transport. And again, for it to be secondary active transport, one of those two solutes would have to be going down its concentration gradient to provide energy for the solute going against its concentration gradient. And neither of these two solutes is going down its concentration gradient, so it's not secondary active transport. It is co-transport. Co-transport just means the channel protein is moving two solutes simultaneously through the channel protein, but it's primary active transport because ATP is the energy source. Okay, this particular protein that you see simultaneously actively transporting potassium ions and sodium ions is kind of a famous protein, and I do want you to know the name of this particular primary active transport protein. It's called the sodium-potassium pump, and the name makes sense, right? Because it's pumping sodium ions and potassium ions, pumping meaning moving them against their concentration gradients. So yes, yeah, so memorize the sodium-potassium pump. It's a channel protein that moves sodium ions and potassium ions simultaneously against their concentration gradients, and it uses ATP as its energy source. This sodium-potassium pump comes up several times in this physiology class. We're going to encounter it in several different chapters this during our Biology 6 class. Now, notice one thing here. The sodium-potassium pump tends to give the cell a negative ionic charge, a negative electrical charge. And here's why. Notice that the cell moves three positive charges, the three sodium ions, out, but it only replaces them with two positive charges, the two potassium ions there. And so if you think of the cell as like a bank, your bank, and if you take $3 out of your account in your bank and only deposit $2, if you keep doing that, you're going to get negative account. You're going to go into debt, right? Because you're taking more dollars out of your account than you're putting in. And so this sodium-potassium pump tends to make cells negatively charged inside, again, because the sodium-potassium pump kicks out three positive charges and only replaces them with two positive charges. So the net effect is loss of positive charge from the cell, and that makes the cell eventually get negatively charged inside. Well, so I mentioned that we're going to see this sodium-potassium pump several times this semester. One place we're going to see it is actually in the next chapter that we're going to do, which is the nervous system. The cells of the nervous system are called neurons, and neurons are negatively charged inside, and the reason is neurons have lots and lots and lots of these sodium-potassium pumps in their membrane. And so, yeah, these neurons are constantly pumping out three sodium ions for every two potassium ions that they move in, and so the net effect is for the cell, to the neuron, to get more and more negative inside. Okay, anyway, so getting back to my original review question here, this protein you see here, the sodium-potassium pump, is doing primary active transport for the potassium ions and the sodium ions simultaneously. Okay, let's do one more drill here. So here's a cell, and for this particular cell, it has a large concentration of glucose molecules inside, and there are a lower concentration of glucose is outside. I know I'm not showing any glucoses, but imagine there's a small concentration of glucose is outside. And this particular cell, it has a larger concentration of sodiums outside than inside. I know I'm not showing any sodiums inside, but imagine there are a few sodiums inside. Okay, so let's say this cell wants to bring in a glucose molecule from the outside. And so let's say the cell has a channel protein that's capable of binding the glucose molecule on the outside. Yeah, so the cell wants to transport that glucose from here to there. And the way the cell is going to do it is this. Notice that those sodium ions want to come inside, right? Because that's the direction of their diffusion. The sodiums want to move down their concentration gradient. And so this channel protein is going to allow one of those sodiums to go down its concentration gradient. And as that sodium does, it's going to essentially push that glucose into the cell. Here's the sodium ion diffusing down its concentration gradient into the cell. And as it does, it drives that glucose. Oh, I gave the answer away, darn it. It drives that glucose in. And so my question is going to be, is that simple diffusion? Is it facilitated diffusion? Is it primary active transport? Is it secondary active transport? And I pushed the button too soon. It is secondary active transport. And so let's review why. So secondary active transport, remember, means where a solute is being pushed against its concentration gradient, and that's what's happening with the glucoses, right? It's moving, they're being moved from their low concentration side to their high concentration side. And if the energy source to pump a solute against its concentration gradient comes from a different solute going down its concentration gradient, like the sodiums in this example, then we say that the channel protein is doing secondary active transport. Okay, good. So hopefully you now have a sense of facilitated diffusion, simple diffusion, primary active transport, and secondary active transport. Well, just to do a quick review, the cell membrane is a barrier that blocks most solutes from diffusing through, but there are some ways that solutes can get through the cell membrane. If the solutes are hydrophobic, they can pass right through the phospholipid bilayer of the cell membrane. We call that process simple diffusion. If the solutes are hydrophilic, we know that the solutes can get through the cell membrane with the help of a channel protein. And there were two subcategories of that. If the solutes were moving through the channel protein from the solute's high concentration side to the solute's low concentration side, we called that facilitated diffusion. But if the cell was pumping the solutes from the solute's low concentration side to the solute's high concentration side, we called that active transport. Okay. So for the hydrophilic solutes, from what I've told you so far, it seems that if the cell wants to move hydrophilic solutes, you know, from one side of the membrane to the other, from what I've told you so far, it seems like there has to be a channel protein involved, right, for hydrophilic solutes. But there's actually a way that the cells can get hydrophilic solutes into or out of the cell that's not through a channel protein. In other words, there's a way for the cell to move hydrophilic solutes, you know, either into the cell or out of the cell, but a way that does not involve channel proteins at all. And basically, the way it works is like this, you know, for this way to do it without a channel protein. So here comes some hydrophilic solutes, and let's say the cell wants to bring these into the cell. Well, those hydrophilic solutes can arrive at the outer part of the cell membrane there. And then what can happen is the cell can bend the membrane inward a little bit, like you see here. And that bent part of the membrane, that inward bend, pinches off from the cell membrane and becomes a vesicle inside the cell. A vesicle is a little round organelle inside the cell that has a wall of membrane around it. But the point is those solutes got into the cell. You know, they're inside a vesicle, but the important point is those solutes came inside the cell. And that process that you just saw has a name. It's called endocytosis, a process that brings solute molecules into the cell by the solute molecules bending the membrane inward, followed by the bent part of the membrane pinching off from the membrane to form a vesicle with the solutes inside it, inside the cell. Here's a close-up. Let's imagine we're going to see that again, but we're going to zoom in on the membrane there. Here's the membrane. Here are those solutes that the cell wants to bring inside. So yeah, there's no channel protein for these solutes, but the way the cell does it is this. The cell bends the membrane inward. Those solutes then come into the bend. The bend part of the membrane pinches off from the rest of the membrane, and now just becomes a vesicle inside the cell. But the point is, the vesicle contains those solutes, so those solutes did get into the cell, and we call that process endocytosis. Now, let's imagine the cell has some solutes inside that it wants to transport out of the cell. And, so that's a vesicle, you know that. Anyway, let's say the cell wants to export these solutes. And again, let's imagine that there's no channel protein for these solutes. Well, the cell can get these solutes to exit the cell by a process called exocytosis, which is essentially endocytosis run in reverse. So if the cell wants to export these solutes by exocytosis, it first loads those solutes up inside a vesicle. So now the solutes are inside the vesicle. Then the cell has that vesicle go to the cell membrane, and the vesicle phospholipids fuse with the membrane phospholipids. In other words, the vesicle fuses with the cell membrane, and in the process, that allows those solute molecules from inside the cell to exit the cell. That is called exocytosis, a process that brings solute molecules out of the cell by a vesicle containing the solutes inside the cell fusing with the cell membrane. Okay, so notice for hydrophilic solutes, they can't pass through the membrane by simple diffusion because the hydrophilic solutes are hydrophilic and the membrane is hydrophobic. So, in some cases, the cell can use a channel protein to allow hydrophilic solutes to get in or out of the cell. But there's this other way. Endocytosis and exocytosis can also be used by the cell to bring solute molecules in or out of the cell. So you might be wondering, well, you know, what would make the cell use a channel protein to move the hydrophilic solutes across versus the cell wanting to use exocytosis and endocytosis? In other words, what would determine whether the cell uses endocytosis and exocytosis versus a channel protein to bring a hydrophilic molecule across the cell membrane? And the answer is usually the size of the molecule. For smaller molecules like individual ions or glucose, which is a fairly small molecule, the cell would tend to use channel proteins. But for larger molecules, the cell would tend to use exocytosis or endocytosis. Okay, well, we might have reached the end of the part of this lecture talking about how the cells transport molecules across the cell membrane. We're now going to switch gears and start talking about osmosis. Okay, well, to understand osmosis, one of the beginning concepts you need to know is that all cells have some solutes inside. Now, what sort of solutes are we talking about? Well, just to give some examples, enzymes you find inside cells. Cells have ATP inside them. Most cells have a pretty high concentration of potassium ions inside them. And although I'm not showing it in this cell right here, cells have some glucose inside them, right? Because they use glucose as their fuel molecule to recharge their ATP supply. And incidentally, you know, cells actually have thousands of different solutes inside them, but these are some of the major ones. Okay, so whenever you picture a cell, just realize that it has some solutes inside of it, like we're picturing here. Okay, so the next step towards understanding osmosis is this. Imagine you could pick up an individual cell in your hand. Here's me holding a cell. Now, this, of course, is absurd because cells are way too small to hold in your hand like that. But just imagine that you could actually hold a cell like that. And imagine that you're going to drop that cell into a glass of pure water, which is what this is down there. Okay, so here I go. Cell dropped. Sploosh. Cell goes down in pure water. Okay, so now here's a close-up of that cell in the pure water like that. You can see it has its solutes inside of it and it's pure water outside. Okay, so notice the solution outside the cell has a lower solute concentration than the cell does. Matter of fact, if it's pure water, it has zero solutes, right? That's what pure water is. Well, any solution that has a lower solute concentration than the cell does is called a hypotonic solution. Hypo means less than, and you could think of tonic as meaning the solute concentration of a cell. Now, incidentally, the hypotonic solution in this thought experiment that we're doing now is pure water, so it has zero solutes in it. It doesn't have to have zero solutes to be a hypotonic solution. Hypotonic solutions can have solutes in them, but to be a hypotonic solution, they just have to have fewer solutes than the cell has. Anyway, so here's a cell in a hypotonic solution. Now, notice these solutes are at a high concentration inside the cell and at zero concentration outside. So by diffusion, these solutes inside the cell want to diffuse out. You know, all solutes want to move from their high concentration area to their low concentration area, but they can't because the cell membrane acts as a barrier that's going to block those solutes from diffusing out of the cell. Okay, so the solutes will not be able to diffuse out of the cell. But if you actually did do this thought experiment, you would see something interesting. Water would start moving from the hypotonic solution into the cell. Now, why is that happening? Well, solutes attract water. That's just sort of a property of all solute molecules. They're like magnets for water. Okay, so yeah, so what you're seeing here, the water molecules moving across the cell membrane, is an example of osmosis. If you look at the web handout, it defines osmosis as the movement of water molecules across a cell membrane, and the water molecules always move towards whichever side of the membrane, you know, like the inside of the membrane, the inside of the cell in this example. The water always moves by osmosis towards the side of the membrane that has the higher solute concentration, you know, which makes sense because remember that the solutes are what are attracting the water molecules. So wherever there's the highest concentration of solutes, that's where the waters are going to move. In the lecture handout, I kind of summarized the basic concept of osmosis. I said water always moves towards solutes. Okay, if you put a cell in a hypotonic solution, again, you know, that means a solution that has a lower solute concentration than the cell does, then the water is always going to move by osmosis into the cell because that's where the higher solute concentration is, and the cell will always gain water if you put it in a hypotonic solution. Now, what's going to happen to the cell? Well, if you ever remember playing with water balloons as a kid, if you add more and more water to a water balloon, it starts to stretch to a larger size, and so as cells gain water in a hypotonic solution, the cell will get larger and larger. And just like a water balloon can burst if you put too much water into it, a cell can undergo lysis. Lysis is the technical science term for something bursting or tearing open, is lysis. Yes, so if you put a cell in a hypotonic solution, the cell will definitely gain water and enlarge, and the cell may lyse, which means burst. Now, the cell won't necessarily burst. It depends on which type of cell it is and how hypotonic the solution is and how long the cell has been sitting in that hypotonic solution, but the cell may undergo lysis. Okay, so now we're going to do sort of a related but slightly different thought experiment. Instead of using pure water, we're now going to make a solution that has a very, very high solute concentration, higher solute concentration than the cell has. And so we could do that by just adding tons and tons of salt to the water or sugar or any other solute. The actual solute doesn't matter in this experiment as long as the solution we're making has a higher solute concentration than the cell does. Okay, so we make our super high solute concentration solution, and then we'll drop a cell into it. Sploosh! All right, and when I click the button, we'll see a close-up of the cell in this super high solute concentration liquid. Here the cell is, and here the high concentration of those solutes. So since we use salt in this example, that's why you see sodium ions and chloride ions, because that's what salt is made out of. But don't get too hung up on the fact that this is a salt solution. The point is that this solution has a higher solute concentration than the cell does. And the name for that type of solution is a hypertonic solution. Hyper means above or greater than. And again, you can think of tonic as meaning the cell solute concentration. So it just means a solution that has a higher solute concentration than the cell has. Okay, so the water is going to move by osmosis. And where do you predict that the water is going to move into the cell or out of the cell? And the answer is out of the cell. Why? Again, because, you know, solutes attract water, and since this is a hypertonic solution, it means there are more solutes in the solution outside the cell than there are solutes inside the cell. So the waters feel a greater pull, pulling them out of the cell. And so, yeah, if you put a cell in a hypertonic solution, the cell will always lose water by osmosis. And incidentally, this is still osmosis, even though the water is moving in the opposite direction than we saw on our first thought experiment. This still counts as osmosis because it's still water moving across a cell membrane towards the higher solute concentration. The only difference is, in this thought experiment, we made the higher solute concentration outside of the cell, whereas in our first thought experiment, we made the higher solute concentration inside the cell. Okay, so what happens to a cell if you put it in a hypertonic solution? Well, I guess I just said that the cells will always lose water by osmosis in a hypertonic solution. But what happens to the cell? Well, it'll shrivel is the answer. Think of a grape. And if you put a grape in the sun so that you evaporate the water out of the grape, it shrivels up into a raisin, right? And so that's what will happen to cells if you put them in a hypertonic solution. They get all shrivelly and crinkly. And if you look at the lecture handout, it says that when you put a cell in a hypertonic solution, well, the cell will lose water and it will shrink, and the cell will crenate. Crenate is the fancy biology term for shrivel. All right, we're going to do yet a third thought experiment now that relates to osmosis. So this time, we're going to add just a small amount of solutes, like, let's say, a dash of salt or a dash of sugar to the water. And so what we're going to do is make the solution exactly equal in solute concentration to a cell. All right, so we made this the solution now equal solute to the cell, and now let's drop a cell in. Sploosh. And now let's zoom in on the cell under the water there. Here it is. Okay, yeah, so what we're saying is the solution outside the cell has exactly the same solute concentration as the cytoplasm of the cell, the inside of the cell. That sort of solution that has the same solute concentration as a cell does is called an isotonic solution. Iso means equal to, and tonic, again, you can think of as meaning the cell solute concentration. Okay, now where will you predict the water will go, if anywhere? And the answer is nowhere, right? Because remember, the idea behind osmosis is that solutes attract the water. Well, if it's the same solute concentration inside of the cell versus outside, then each water molecule is going to feel equal pull, you know, pulling out and pulling in. And, you know, if you get pulled equally in two directions, you go nowhere, right? And so if you put a cell in an isotonic solution, the cell does not gain or lose any water. The cell keeps its normal, natural shape. Okay, good. Well, so the next slide kind of reviews these three types of solutions: hypertonic, hypotonic, and isotonic. So this, just so you understand this illustration, this is a red blood cell, and this red blood cell's normal, natural shape. And what allowed this red blood cell to keep its normal, natural shape is that it was put in an isotonic solution. And remember, that's what cells do in isotonic solutions. They don't gain or lose any water by osmosis, so they stay their natural normal shape. This red blood cell, however, was soaked in a hypertonic solution. Remember, in hypertonic solutions, cells lose water and shrink and crenate. They get all shrivelly looking. And this red blood cell was put in a hypotonic solution. Remember, in hypotonic solutions, cells gain water and expand, and they may lyse, they may burst. Okay, now, if you were a cell, which solution would you rather be in? Well, the obvious answer is this one right here. You know, if you were a cell, you want to keep your normal, natural shape. That's your healthiest state to be in. You don't want to be all crenated and shrunken. That wouldn't be healthy. And as a cell, you don't want to be expanded and stretched and risk lysing. That wouldn't be healthy either. Yeah, so cells are happiest and healthiest in isotonic solutions. And so given that, it should be no surprise when I tell you that your blood and your other body fluids are all isotonic solutions. Your body wants to keep your cells in their normal, healthy, happy shape. And so your body makes all of your body fluids isotonic solutions. Now, when we go to the hospital and they give us an intravenous solution, an IV solution, you know, sometimes they give it to us in this bag where they drip the contents of the liquid in the bag into our blood vessels, or sometimes they might just give us an injection of some sort of fluid. But anytime they're putting some sort of hospital fluid into our blood vessels, we say that they're giving us an intravenous solution or an IV solution. Almost always the IV solutions that the hospital gives you are isotonic solutions, which, you know, should make sense because they're essentially giving you new body fluids, right? They're putting some new fluids inside your body, and they don't want those solutions that they put into your body. They don't want those IV solutions to be hypertonic because then your cells would get all crenated and shrunken, and they don't want those IV solutions that they give you to be hypotonic because then your cells will enlarge to a bigger size and may risk lysis. So it's healthiest for your cells when they give you isotonic IV solutions in the hospital. In your lecture handout, I listed some common isotonic IV solutions, so let me quickly go through those. Probably the most common isotonic hospital IV solution is 0.9% saline. Saline is an old term for sodium chloride, which is just salt. And so basically 0.9% saline is a salt solution at 0.9% concentration. And at that concentration, 0.9% salt water is isotonic to your cells. So this is an isotonic solution. It's sometimes called normal saline. In hospitals, 0.9% sodium chloride. Another common isotonic hospital solution is called Ringer's lactate. And Ringer's lactate contains several different solutes. It has some salts, it has some potassium, it has some lactic acid in it. But the point is, the grand total of all those solutes in Ringer's lactate is isotonic to your cells. So Ringer's lactate is also an isotonic solution. And one more, there is a isotonic hospital IV solution called 0.5% dextrose. Dextrose is an old term for glucose. So this is basically glucose sugar water. And at this concentration, 5%, the glucose is isotonic to your cells. So 5% dextrose is an isotonic solution. Okay, so yeah, almost always hospital IV solutions are isotonic. Under a few very, very rare circumstances, hospitals might give a patient a slightly hypertonic or slightly hypotonic solution. But as I said, those are very rare circumstances, and almost always the IV solutions that they give us are isotonic ones. Now, one of the skills that I want you to learn from this lecture is the ability to do osmosis problems. And you may say, well, what is an osmosis problem? And it basically means predicting whether the water is going to move into or out of a cell. So let's imagine here's a cell. And as you can see, the cell has some solutes inside. And these, you know, these little hexagons and triangular-shaped things represent the solutes inside the cell. And these other shapes outside the cell represent the solutes in the solution outside the cell. So in a typical osmosis problem, I'll tell you the concentration of all the solutes, like the concentration of this type of solute and the concentration of that solute and the concentration of that type of solute and the concentration of that type of solute. So I tell you all the solute concentrations, and then you have to predict whether the water is going to move into the cell or if the water is going to move out of the cell by osmosis. That's what I mean by osmosis problems. And yes, I want you to learn to be able to do osmosis problems. Okay, so the basic idea when I give you an osmosis problem is find out what the total solute concentration is inside the cell by adding up the concentrations of all the individual solutes that are present inside the cell, and then find the total solute concentration outside the cell by adding up the individual solute concentrations that are present outside the cell. And then once you have the total solute concentration inside the cell compare it to the total solute concentration outside the cell, and then whichever one of those solute concentrations is higher, that's where the water is going to move to by osmosis, because remember, osmosis says that water always moves towards the higher solute concentration. Okay, but there's a couple of nuances to doing these osmosis problems. I mean, on the surface, it sounds like it's fairly easy. Just add up the concentrations, and whichever one is higher, that's where the water is going to move. But yeah, there are a couple of nuances. There are a couple of tricks. And one nuance is you can't use the normal concentration units that you were taught in your chemistry class. So, you know, chemistry is a prerequisite for taking biology 6. So chemistry is a prerequisite for taking biology 6. And in your chemistry class, you learned about concentration units. Concentration units are the chemist's way of talking about what the concentration of a solution is. And all concentration units tell you how much of the solute there is per some volume of solution. So here's an example. A very common concentration unit that you were taught in chemistry class is grams of solute per liter of solution. So yeah, notice that's a concentration unit. It tells you how much of the solute there is per some volume of the solution, per 1 liter of solution in this example. Another fairly common concentration unit, maybe used a little bit more than grams per liter in medical settings, is grams of solute per 100 milliliters of the solution. But, you know, that's still a concentration unit. And in chemistry, you probably also learned a concentration unit called molarity, which is moles of the solute per liter of the solution. Okay, yeah, so these are sort of standard concentration units that you learn in chemistry courses. The problem is these don't work for osmosis problems. And what I mean is they don't work is if you tried to use these types of concentration units when you're adding up the solute concentrations, you might get the wrong prediction in terms of where the water is going to move. Well, so you might say, okay, well, what concentration units do I use? Well, there's a different concentration unit, different from all three of these, that's tailor-made for doing osmosis problems. It's, in other words, it's the correct concentration unit that you use for the solutes when you're doing an osmosis problem. And this concentration unit is called osmolarity concentration units, or OSM. Is its abbreviation. Yeah, so this is, it's a concentration unit, but it's different from the ones you see here, and this is the one that you need to use to do osmosis problem. This is the concentration unit that always will allow you to get the correct prediction in terms of where the water is going to move in osmosis problems. I will always, in these osmosis problems that I give you in this Bio 6 course, I will always give you the solute concentrations in osmolarity units. In other words, I'm not going to make you mathematically convert from grams per liters into osmolarity, or from grams per 100 milliliters to osmolarity, or from moles per liter into osmolarity. I will always just start you on these, so you don't worry about any mathematical conversions. But do realize that osmolarity is a concentration unit, and it's the right concentration unit for doing osmosis problems. Okay, so let us do an osmosis problem. All right, so let's imagine there's a cell, and let's say I tell you that the cell has two types of solutes inside of it, solute A and solute B. And of course, that's absurd because, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, real cells have thousands of different types of solute molecules inside them. But yeah, let's just be simple and say this particular cell only has two solute types inside of it. We'll call it solute A and solute B. And let's say I also tell you that the concentration of solute A inside the cell is 0.3 osmolarity units, and the concentration of solute B inside the cell is 1.2 of these osmolarity concentration units. All right, and let's say I tell you that outside the cell are two types of solutes, some of that solute A, and there's also another solute called solute C. And outside the cell, the solution outside the cell, the concentration of solute A is 0.6 OSM, and the concentration of solute C is 1.0 OSM. Okay, so a typical osmosis problem would be something like you see here. I tell you the solutes outside the cell and inside the cell and what their concentrations are, then I say, where will the water move? Will it move out of the cell or into the cell? All right, so when doing an osmosis problem, you find the total solute concentration inside the cell, just adding up the concentrations of the individual solutes inside the cell, to get the total inside the cell, and then do the same thing outside the cell, the solution outside the cell, find its total solute concentration. And just so you know, the water doesn't care what solutes they are. Water doesn't care if it's solute A or solute C or B or glucose or salt or proteins. The cell doesn't care. All the cell cares about is what the total solute concentration is inside versus outside. Anyway, to do an osmosis problem, you just add up the total solute concentration outside the cell and also add up the total solute concentration inside the cell. So to find the total solute concentration outside the cell, you just add up all the solutes outside the cell. 0.6 plus 1.0, those osmolarity units, equals 1.6 total osmolarity concentration outside the cell of solutes. And the total solute concentration inside the cell is 1.5 osmolarity. All right, so now if I tell you, where's the water going to move? Hopefully you'd say, Mr. Edens, the water's going to move outside the cell, because by osmosis, water always moves across cell membranes towards the higher solute concentration. And so you would be correct. Congratulations, you've just done your first osmolarity problem. All right, that was so much fun. Let's do a second osmolarity problem. So let's say I tell you there's a certain cell that has only two solutes inside of it, two types of solutes, solute Y and solute Z. And let's say I tell you that the concentration of solute Y inside the cell is 0.8 OSM, and the concentration of solute Z inside the cell is 0.8 OSM. And let's say in the solution outside the cell, there's only one solute, we'll call it solute X, and its concentration is 1.3 OSM. Okay, so again, to do an osmolarity problem, you find the total solute concentration inside the cell and the total solute concentration outside the cell, and then you compare those two. And what I mean by that is the water will move towards the higher one. Okay, so outside the cell, there's only one solute, so the total solute concentration outside the cell is the same as that one solute, 1.3 OSM. The total solute concentration inside the cell is 1.6, right? If you add up the 0.8 and 0.8, you get a total of 1.6. Okay, so where's the water going to move? And if you said towards the inside of the cell, you would be correct. You know, the water always moves by osmosis towards whichever side of the membrane the higher solute concentration is. Okay, so so far so good. You know, seems like these osmosis problems aren't so bad. But there's a second sort of nuance, a second sort of tricky thing that I need to tell you about now. Okay, let me begin explaining this second tricky thing like this. So here's a cell, and as usual here you see the solutes inside, and remember that some of the most abundant solutes inside cells are potassium ions and proteins, along with, you know, some ATP and glucose also. But anyway, these represent some of the major solutes that you find inside cells. All right, so yeah, these represent the concentration of the solutes inside the cell. And here are some solutes outside the cell. Now, at this point in the experiment, all these solutes outside the cell are concentrated together. When I click the button, they're going to diffuse, right? You know, all solutes want to diffuse, so they're going to start moving from their high concentration areas to their low concentration areas. Well, the solutes that we're going to be doing this experiment right here are called non-penetrating solutes. And that just means solutes that can't diffuse across the cell membrane. And that's pretty much the type of solutes we've been talking about so far when we've done these osmosis problems. Like in the osmosis problems that we did a couple minutes ago, I didn't tell you anything about some solutes diffusing through the cell membranes. And so, yeah, think of non-penetrating solutes as being the kind of standard solutes for osmosis problems. And again, that means that they're not able to diffuse across the membrane. So when I click the button, we'll see them diffuse, you know, outside the cell, but none of them will be able to penetrate the cell membrane. That's why they call them non-penetrating solutes. So they will not diffuse into the cell. And just to make this problem interesting, let's say that the concentration of these non-penetrating solutes is high enough so that even when they spread out, even when they diffuse, they'll have a higher solute concentration than the cell has. Okay, so here are these non-penetrating solutes diffusing, and yeah, just like you can see, they are non-penetrating, meaning they can't diffuse through the cell membrane. The cell membrane is impermeable to them. Okay, good. So yeah, so they spread out until they're evenly spread out. But like I said, in this experiment, we're thinking that even when these non-penetrating solutes have diffused until they're evenly spread out, they're still at a higher solute concentration than the cell has. So if I were to say, all right, where's the water going to move? You should say, well, Mr. Edens, you just told us the higher solute concentration is outside the cell, so the water will exit the cell. And you would be correct. And of course, if I said, well, what's the shape of the cell going to do? You would say, Mr. Edens, the cell will crenate because of the water loss. Okay, so yeah, so if I tell you that the solute is a non-penetrating solute, it means its solute doesn't cross the cell membrane. That's the important point here. Okay, so now we're going to do a new but related experiment. So here's the cell again, with its normal solutes inside, and here's a different sort of solute on the outside. Again, when I click the button, we're going to see this solute diffuse. This solute's all concentrated here right now, but yeah, when I click the button, we'll watch it diffuse. But this type of solute is a type of solute that we call a penetrating solute, and that is defined as a solute that can diffuse across the cell membrane. And remember from our earlier discussion, well, what types of solutes can diffuse across cell membranes? Well, hydrophobic solutes, so all hydrophobic solutes are penetrating solutes. But remember also that cell membranes sometimes have channel proteins that allow certain hydrophilic solutes to pass through the cell membrane. So if a cell happens to have a channel protein for a hydrophilic solute, then that hydrophilic solute is a penetrating solute because it can get through the cell membrane, you know, using a channel protein on the cell, but it still counts as a penetrating solute if it can get through the membrane even by a channel protein. So again, penetrating solutes mean ones that can pass through the cell membrane, can diffuse through the cell membrane, and so those can be either hydrophobic solutes or hydrophilic solutes that the cell happens to have a channel protein for. Okay, so when I click the button, we'll see those penetrating solutes diffusing, and remember, they are penetrating, so they are going to be able to diffuse through the cell membrane. Of course, they'll also diffuse into the solution outside the cell membrane like that. Okay, these penetrating solutes have spread themselves out, and remember that when a solute is diffusing, it spreads itself out until it's evenly spread out. Let me go back one second. There we go. It spreads itself out until it's evenly spread out. Now, to make the rest of this explanation more sense, I'm going to temporarily make the solutes, the cell solutes, like the potassium and the enzymes and the ATP, I'm going to temporarily make those invisible. They're still there inside the cell, but to make this explain better, let me just temporarily make them invisible. Okay, so what I was saying is, as far as this penetrating solute is concerned, it does what all solutes do. They spread themselves out until they're evenly distributed. And so that means the solute for this penetrating solute, the triangular ones, it's going to get the same concentration outside the cell as inside, right? Because that's what solutes do when they diffuse. They spread themselves evenly out. And just a reminder, we saw that here. Here, at the first part of this experiment, these green ink solute molecules were all concentrated here, but they diffuse. They spread themselves out until they were completely evenly spread out, the same solute concentration everywhere. So I'm saying that's what that penetrating solute can do. When it diffuses, since the cell membrane is not a barrier, it reaches the exact same solute concentration inside the cell as outside the cell. Okay, so given that the penetrating solute ends up with being at the same concentration inside the cell as outside the cell, what effect will it have on the water molecules? And your answer should be, well, no effect, right? Because it's the same solute concentration. For that solute, it's the same solute concentration inside the cell and outside the cell. And so since osmosis works by solutes pulling on water molecules, all the water molecules are going to be equally pulled by the solute in and out, which means they're not going to move anywhere, right? And so this penetrating solute is not going to have any effect on water movement. And again, why is that so? Because since it's penetrating, it ends up at the same solute concentration outside the cell and inside the cell, and a solute that's at the same concentration outside the cell and inside the cell is not going to have any net pulling effect on water molecules. And so this particular solute, this penetrating solute, is not going to have any effect on water movement. And so at first you might be tempted to say, so the cell's not going to gain or lose water because the solute's at equal concentration. Well, this particular solute's not going to have any effect on water movement. But remember that at the beginning of this problem, I said there are some solutes inside the cell, you know, the cell's own solutes. And those ones are not going to be able to pass through the cell membrane. And so we have to consider these solutes also now. So what I'm saying is the blue ones, the triangular ones, because they're the same concentration inside and outside, are not going to have any effect on water molecule movement. But we do have to consider the solutes that are not able to pass through the membrane, like these ones inside the cell. We still have to consider their effect on water movement. And so what I'm basically saying is you can just ignore penetrating solutes. They don't affect water movement because they always end up the same concentration outside and inside. So if I give you an osmosis problem that has penetrating solutes as part of it, just ignore them. Just pretend they're invisible. They don't count at all towards the movement of the water because they get the same. They end up at the same concentration outside and inside. And so just focus your attention on the non-penetrating solutes, the ones that can't pass through the membrane. So, you know, ignoring those penetrating solutes and focusing on the non-penetrating ones that you see here, where's the water going to move? And the correct answer is into the cell, right? Because if we just focus on the non-penetrating solutes, they're at a higher concentration inside the cell, higher than outside the cell. Okay, so the lesson here is when I give you osmosis problems, I'm also going to tell you whether we're talking about penetrating or non-penetrating solutes. And for the penetrating solutes, just ignore them. Pretend they don't exist because they don't affect water movement because they end up the same concentration inside or outside of the cell. Or saying the same thing slightly different way, only focus your attention on the non-penetrating solutes. They are the only ones that can cause movement in osmosis problems. So let me give you a sample here. So what's the cell going to do? Well, it will expand from taking on the water and it may lyse. Okay, so let's do some osmosis problems. So let's say I tell you there's a certain cell and it has two solutes inside. Let's call them solute A and solute B. And solute A is at a concentration of 0.3 OSM and solute B is at a concentration of 1.2 OSM. And outside the cell, let's say, I think I gave you this problem before. Let's say there's two solutes, solute A and solute C, and their concentrations are 0.6 OSM and 1.0 OSM respectively. And let's say I also tell you that all of these solutes are non-penetrating. All of these are the ones that cannot cross the cell membrane. Then you should say, okay, Mr. Edens, I'm good to go because I don't have to worry about any of these solutes diffusing across the cell membrane. These ones that are outside will stay outside. These ones that are inside will stay inside. And so I can just go ahead and add up the total concentrations, piece of cake. So total solute concentration outside the cell is 1.6 OSM. Total solute concentration inside the cell is 1.5 OSM. And so you just used to say, Mr. Edens, that water is going to exit the cell by osmosis because that's where the higher solute concentration is, and you are correct. Okay, so fairly straightforward problem because all the solutes are non-penetrating in the osmosis problem. Now let's get a little tricky. We'll keep the same solute concentrations, but now let's say, I'm going to switch things up a little bit. Now let's say I tell you that solute C is a penetrating solute. And now I ask you, well, where's the water going to go to? I guess in the last problem, the water moved outside the cell, right? When all the solutes were non-penetrating. But now I tell you solute C is a penetrating solute. And now I say, well, where's the water going to go? Well, so remember that when you do osmosis problems, just completely ignore penetrating solutes. They don't affect the osmosis of the water because the penetrating solute becomes the same solute concentration inside and outside the cell. So just completely ignore any penetrating solutes. And so you'd say, okay, Mr. Edens, outside the cell, the total solute concentration, I'm going to consider it to be 0.6 because I'm ignoring any penetrating solutes when I do osmosis problems. So 0.6 OSM outside the cell. And inside the cell, you know, the total concentration of non-penetrating solutes is 0.5. Now where's the water going to go? And into the cell is the correct answer, right? Because that's where the higher concentration of the non-penetrating solutes is. So, the lesson here is that you have to take into consideration, when you do osmosis problems, you have to take into consideration whether the solutes that you're talking about are penetrating or non-penetrating, and just ignore any penetrating ones. They don't really enter into the osmosis problem. Okay, we have one more topic left in this lecture, and it's different from the diffusion and osmosis that we've been talking about so far. This last topic is called the fluid compartments of the body, and if you look at the lecture handout, it defines those as the regions of the body that contain the body fluids. You might say, well, what do you mean, the regions of the body that contain the body fluids? Well, let me give you an example. So let's zoom in a little bit here. And so here are her blood vessels, you know, things like arteries and veins and capillaries. Well, of course, the blood is flowing through those blood vessels. And so we might ask, well, so that's a region of the body, you know, the blood vessels, and it contains body fluids. And so, you know, that is a fluid compartment of the body, her blood vessels, since it contains body fluids. Now, we might ask, okay, well, what volume of fluid does she have in her blood vessels? And if we concentrate on the plasma of the blood, which is the fluid, the liquid part of the blood, the answer is 3 liters. So an average adult has 3 liters of plasmid in their blood vessels, 3 liters of plasma in their blood vessels. Now, I should mention here, remember, blood consists of blood cells and the plasma, the cell part of the blood and the liquid part of the blood. And the plasma is the liquid part of the blood. So this 3 liters means just the liquidy part of the blood, and because that's what we're focusing on now, you know, the fluids, the liquids. If we talk about, well, what's the volume of the blood if we include the blood cells and the plasma, for a typical adult, that's 5 liters. But in this lecture, we're just focusing on the fluids of the body, so we're just focusing on the plasma of the blood, the liquid part of the blood. And so the average adult, 3 liters is in their plasma, is the volume of their plasma. Okay, now our body contains lots of cells too, right? And I'm going to use these little purple dots to represent the cells of the body. And I don't know how many cells I'm showing in this illustration, maybe 100 or so. But obviously our bodies can contain a lot more than 100 cells. They think that an average adult has around 75 trillion cells in their body. But let's just go with the ones I'm showing here to represent all the trillions of cells in the body. Well, remember, each cell has its cytoplasm. The cytoplasm is the liquid that fills each cell. So we might ask, well, what volume of fluid is if I add up all the cytoplasms and all the cells in the human body? And that would be around 30 liters. I wrote here 30 liters in cells, but that's the fluid, the 30 liters, that's the 30 liters of the grand total of all the fluid contained inside all of your cells. So adding up all the cytoplasms of all your trillions of cells, a grand total of around 30 liters, which, you know, is kind of fascinating. It's 10 times more than the volume of plasma in your blood vessels. Okay, there's one more fluid I want to mention here called the tissue fluid. So look here. There are spaces right around here that are not inside the cells. You know, we're moving this little pointer. You can see it's not inside the cells. So it's outside the cells. But at least in these regions here, it's not inside blood vessels, right? There's no blood vessels right there. Well, the fact is that there is a watery fluid called the tissue fluid that fills the spaces between your cells. And the grand total of all the tissue fluid that you have throughout your entire body is 12 liters of tissue fluid. Okay, so these two, the tissue fluid and the plasma, those are body fluids that are outside your cells, whereas this 30 liters here, that's the represents, you know, all this, all your cytoplasm, the liquids that are inside the cells. Well, because these two are fluids that are outside your cells, they can be sometimes be lumped together in what they call the extracellular compartment. So when people use that phrase in physiology classes, what they mean is your tissue fluid and your plasma, because those are your body fluids that are outside of your cells. And yeah, the grand total for an adult is 15 liters in the fluid in their extracellular compartment. And, you know, this 30 liters of the grand total of the cytoplasm in all your cells, that's sometimes called the intracellular compartment. Intracellular means inside the cells. So grand total of 30 liters of fluid you have is in your intracellular compartment, whereas your extracellular compartment, the areas of your body outside your cells, a grand total of around 15 liters of fluid total. Okay, now sometimes when we, you know, when we go into hospitals, they give us IV solutions, intravenous solutions. You know, maybe there's some sort of medicine that they want to give us. And so with these IV solutions, they drip them into our blood vessels, you know, either an IV bag like you see here, or sometimes just, you know, an injection, a shot. But they, you know, they give us these IV solutions in the hospital like this. Okay, so when I click the button here, we're going to see these solutes, the blue triangles, come through there. And the question is going to be, well, where do they go in the body? And you might say, well, you just told us that, Mr. Edens. You said that they're putting this into her blood vessels, so they're going to go inside her blood. And, you know, that's true. These solutes here in the IV solution will go inside her plasma. You know, that's the liquidy part of the blood. But as you'll see here in a moment, they're also going, the solutes will also be able to get out of the blood vessels and go into her tissue fluid, the watery fluid between her cells. And so let's watch that happening here. Here they go inside her plasma, so into her blood vessels. But very soon, almost immediately actually, they start escaping from the blood vessels, and they start going into the tissue fluid, the watery liquid between her cells. Like you can see that one right there, and that one right there, and this one right here are in her tissue fluid. Good, yeah, so when they put solute molecules by IV into your blood vessels, some of those stay inside the blood vessels, but some of them get out of the blood vessels and get into your tissue fluid. And you might wonder, well, how do the solute molecules do that? How do they get out of your blood vessels? Well, let us imagine maybe a close-up of one of her blood vessels. Here it is right here. There are different types of blood vessels. There are arteries and veins and capillaries. So let's imagine that this particular blood vessel we're talking about is a capillary blood vessel. Well, so the blood is inside the capillary, and we're focusing on the liquid part of the blood, the plasma. Well, the fact is, as you can see from this drawing, capillaries have little holes in their walls. I shouldn't say little holes. Some of these holes are actually fairly large. But all capillaries have holes in their walls, and that allows molecules in the plasmid to get out of the capillary and go into the tissue fluid. Here's the tissue fluid in this part of the diagram. These are some cells, and yeah, again, the tissue fluid is the watery liquid that you find between the cells. Yeah, so what I'm saying is for any of solutes in your blood, they're very easily able to escape out of the blood vessels thanks to those little holes in the capillaries, and they go into your tissue fluid. So yeah, so the message here is any solutes in your blood, whether they're put in there artificially, you know, by an IV solution in a hospital, or solutes that occur naturally in your blood, it doesn't matter. They are able to get out of your blood vessels and get into your tissue fluid. So you'll find whatever solutes are in your blood, you'll also find some of those same solutes in and amongst your tissue fluid. Now, for the purposes of full disclosure here, there's only one type of solute in the blood that's too large to leak out of the capillaries, and those are what are called the plasma proteins. Plasma proteins are pretty much what they sound like. There are proteins in the plasma. Plasma proteins are just too big to fit through these little holes. But other than that, all molecules in the plasma are small enough to get out of these holes and go into the tissue fluid. As a good example, water, you know, the plasma is a watery liquid, so it's mostly made up of water. So water molecules in the plasma can get through these little holes and become part of the tissue fluid. In fact, that's where the water of the tissue fluid comes from, water molecules that have leaked out of the capillaries. And, you know, glucose, these cells have to get glucose, right, as a fuel molecule. Well, the cells, the glucose comes out of your blood vessels, out of these little holes in your blood vessels, and goes into the tissue fluid, and then the cells get their glucose actually from the tissue fluid. So yeah, so pretty much all molecules in your plasma, other than proteins, are small enough All molecules are small enough, other than proteins, to leak out of your blood vessels, and so that's why all molecules in your plasma also go into your tissue fluid. Okay, so yeah, in your lecture handout, I said that liquids and solutes in the blood can easily enter the tissue fluid and vice versa. So molecules in the tissue fluid can easily go inside the blood. And how that happens again is that your capillaries have these little holes in them to allow molecules to easily go back and forth between the tissue fluid and the plasma. Now, I think when I started this example, I said that this was some sort of medicine. These particular solid molecules represented some sort of medicine that was in the IV solution. So you might wonder, huh, well, okay, so this, you might say, okay, so this medicine solute was able to get out of the plasma and into the tissue fluid. You might say, will it be able to get inside the cell? And that depends on the exact nature of this solute. If it's a penetrating solute, yes, penetrating solutes can cross cell membranes and so can get inside the cell. But if it's a non-penetrating solute, then it's not going to be able to get inside the cell. So whether a given molecule can get out of the blood and into your cells depends whether it's a penetrating or non-penetrating solute, but the molecule will definitely be able to get out of the plasma and go into the tissue fluid. Okay, well, that is the end of this lecture on diffusion, osmosis, and transport across membranes. Thank you for listening, and as usual, I recommend that you now do the online review questions on this topic.